first thing to talk about in this before I actually complete the setup is player seating locations. If player order is very important, you'd think maybe the game was designed with that in mind and they had seating locations in planning, and that my usual, hey, instead of moving clockwise, I'll move counterclockwise, might be problematic. But there's no statement to that effect. In fact, there doesn't seem to be any preference as to people sitting in particular places. That's a little weird in my head, but whatever. If there had been such a statement, I would worry more about what I'm doing. But instead, I'm just giving one deck of cards to France and one to the player to their right, who's actually going to be the last player. Because I go... No. I tend to go counterclockwise. I'm just wondering if I can go clockwise this time. Because, yeah, normally France would be your first player. So this is the reason. I think I'll go clockwise this game. We'll see if I can do that without screwing myself over completely. How big a deal is it who the first player is? Well, it is something of a big deal. Because if you're doing a combat action, if you do yours first, the other guy can react and move into your area. If you do a diplomacy action first, you can counter. Yeah, you can maybe form an alliance with him before he gets a chance to attack you, and he might not be prepared for that and have to use his combat somewhere else. So there's a lot of little points towards, gee, what do you want to do and why? So yeah, I'm gonna try to move counterclockwise, because when I looked at it, I said, well, military and political goes into France's hands, moving that next to England, to Sweden, that makes sense, to Russia. Poland in kind of the middle makes sense. Arts, well, what doesn't make sense is not giving arts to France. But anyway, that's where we are. Let's look at the different advantages here. So the English have +3 when they're in battle or negotiations with whoever the game leader is. Now, there's no clear victory point track on this game, but you can tell who's winning. 2 points for this, 3 points for the lead in this, 1 point for second place in this, likewise here, coins that you have, territories you have, all the victory points can be added up at any point, but there's no immediate... Yeah, I can see where that is. We're also going to have to use some kind of marker to indicate who's used their once per game abilities, because there's nothing to help you remember that. His foreign ruler bonus is, or penalty, is he can't use enhancements when defending any of his home territory, even the Netherlands. Yeah, the Dutch are annoying even to William. And then emerging empire, once per turn, he can double his coin once during the tax and trade phase. Over here for Louis, he starts the game with the lowest space on the art and science track. That's sort of a once per game ability, isn't it? It doesn't give him this constant bonus, but it gives him a starting position in there and current leadership in the game to 8 points ahead. He's an object of envy, though. He gets -2 on every cultural census throughout the game to his total, which kind of sucks. And I assume that also includes the Catholic, anti-Catholic. That makes sense. The French were not as Catholic as others were. And then cultivate greatness. Once per game, he can exhaust a luminary instead of removing him from the game. Let's take a look at Philip here. He doesn't pay upkeep for conquered territories. That's really cool. Other players, their conquests are going to be really, really painful for them. So grabbing victory points that way is going to cost you, and you're going to have to constantly be raising taxes to pay for your conquests. Plus, you might lose them if you take things. Now, there is one advantage to conquests I forgot to mention. When you conquer a territory that's not your religion, you move the religion marker once in your favor. And that's one of the reasons conquest was happening a lot in the two-player game. I don't know if it's going to be as violent in the multiplayer game, because you're helping a lot of people with your battle. But it will create one axis along which alliances are going to be formed. -1 to all battle, negotiation, and census stacks. Okay, so that makes it harder to conquest. And then also, he's got a penalty on the census almost as bad as the object of envy. And then, well, is that... See, cultural census, when discussed here, includes the religious census. So I say yes, it does affect that as well. Once per game, he begins the game with his full treasury limit in coin. Yeah, we did that already. You can't cancel that out, I guess. Leopold meets all religious Catholic requirements and receives +3 to his total in the religious cultural census. Well, that'll help the anti-Catholic penalty built into the dice roll a little bit. But what that means is anytime he has to play a card that requires... crosses, he gets to fire that off. I don't think it means that if he puts political in, he doesn't have to worry about his Catholic points in there, but I'm not sure. I think it's just that cards that require you to have to exhaust a certain number of crosses or whatever are in play there, but maybe not. Who knows? We do have this compendium. But that particular thing is not listed here. Most things are not. Okay. Less capable, -1 to battles and negotiations. Yeah. And once per game, he can cancel a religious census just before it begins, exhausting all participants. Well, there's only two religious censuses in the game maximum, so that could be pretty big. Sobieski here can use two enhancements in any military stack. So attack or defense, he can... He can bonus himself. And you can only attack once per turn. Politically isolated, may only have one ally at a time. Now, I don't know how big a disadvantage that is, because it also means that nobody can force you into an alliance. And Lion of Liechtenstein, once per game, he gets to reroll his dice after an unsuccessful attack against Islamic territories. Islamic territories are not... the neutral stuff. So nobody can help these. So they look like a nice point section there. At least that's how I'm reading this. All players are allied with the single independent territories. I would say the Ottoman Empire is not a single independent territory, and it's actually meat for these guys up here. On the other hand, it's only worth victory points. You're not going to get the Catholic anti-Catholic modifier by conquering those. Okay. Committed to progress. If leading in science and or art, he gets a point of prestige. What's prestige? Is that the victory conditions? That's what I'm guessing, because they talk about prestige there. Yeah, okay. -2 to all negotiations, and exhaust an additional politics when he does diplomacy. Well, diplomacy costs you 5 already. He just costs 6. But he's also not good if it comes to a military if it comes to a negotiation after military. And visionary, once per game during an action selection phase, advance 2 science or art. Doesn't say that anything is cost for that. Like, it's not like, it doesn't seem to indicate I have to burn an action to do that. That would be what I'd think, but... Warmonger, +2 every time you attack. -4 on any negotiations, though. But once per game, if a battle's about to turn into negotiations, screw it, let's just attack. Sweet. Okay. Now I've got the 2 decks of cards. This one's going to circle around that way. This one's going to circle that way. And we're going to try to play it clockwise if we can. Okay, so at this point, I've picked each player's initial draft. And now, starting with France, we get to start picking the additional luminaries that they start with. Now, for example, here was my initial set. I had no choice with Pope Clement, but he helps me decide what else, along with my powers. And, of course, I had a first choice at the military political side. For the military political, I took the enhancement model army from Frederick Wilhelm, which, if he's involved in an attack, I can return the other cards in my stack back to my hand, and it exhausts the elector. That's potent. If I send him off on an attack, if I have other military characters, I can pull them back, and then I have them to defend. So I can do an attack from the first card and then still be defended. That's a very powerful option, especially if I'm going early in a turn. The Pope, whenever I advance Catholicism in an action, and that could include an attack against a Protestant area, even though he doesn't have any combat capability, I get an extra science from putting him in. And then I got kind of stuck with not a lot of choices, and Pascal seemed the best of the two that I was given, which is he's doubled on any cultural censuses, which makes him very powerful towards the science value. But we'll see how that works out. Now, given what I have, I have some money production available. But I probably want more. I had an option to take Colbert, who's very powerful, for that. I think money feels like a weakness, so I'm going to grab a politics card as one of my seven. And unfortunately, I get somebody who's not terribly useful here. Political lynching. Automatically win a negotiation after the stacks are created, but before they're revealed, and choose a luminary your opponent used to remove. Remove Kivet and another of your involved luminaries. Remove, of course, is putting back in the bottom of the stacks. They're essentially dead. Well, you know, there's some luck in terms of what you draw in these. Now here, and I'm not going to go through all of them, but the English are going to make the next check. Colbert, who, as I said, was very potent, he can ignore requirements to exhaust or discard wealth. So this is one of two things. Exhaust would be wealth, or spend, discard coins from any of your actions. Colbert is not exhausted or removed by exercising this ability. Now that confuses me, because I think you have to play these guys with the enhancement, and I'm not sure what it means to not exhaust him. Does he go back to your hand, you know, and is he at all useful for that? Now, elsewhere I looked, and there's other things that make it sound like enhancements don't necessarily go with someone who's being played on the thing. I played it where you have to play the guy that you're going to use the enhancement for. If you're not going to use the enhancement along with playing the card, it makes them much less valuable in general. So it means you have to hold the card in your hand and use it in an unplanned fashion. Basically, you have to hold it in reserve and not add its points to the battle, to the endeavor, which sounds horrible. So for example, this guy advanced two additional art each time your side wins any cultural census. Well, that means I can't commit, if that reading is correct that I'm suggesting, that means I can't commit him to a cultural census, which means, you know, he's good at art. I'd want him there, right? So that's really annoying if that's how you have to read it. The rules don't make it clear one way or another. I'm going to play it the way I explained it, which is that you have to commit somebody to use their enhancement, but we'll see elsewhere. For example, this guy says, add to any action which will gain you science. If the outcome is successful, you gain additional stuff. That makes it sound like you put him in from your hand. Others don't, you know, elsewhere it's not really clear whether you hold off on your enhancements, if you have to play your enhancement into the pile or not. And that kind of confuses me. Anyway, he was kind of a last choice for the Brits. Because, well, minus Pascal. So, I don't know what I'm looking at here. I have decent money over here on Colbert. And this is kind of problematic because I want to put Colbert in my taxes and trade, but he's got this cool ability too. I seem to be lacking any military ability though, and you need that because otherwise you're going to lose the Netherlands or whatever. So we'll pull, it's the Dread Pirate Roberts. He chooses a colonial power to pirate. Now the colonial powers are just France, Spain, and England in this, and take $3 from them and exhaust him. He's also decent at combat and decent at creating money, so he's not a bad choice. He's not exactly what I would have picked. Let's go through an entire cycle of these so you can see what the initial picks were here. William Penn, he allowed, and these are going to be used throughout the game. Now, it is indeed the case, the rules say just flip them over in here once you use them. I'm going to actually, once they're exhausted, I'm going to actually put them in the exhausted pile. So there's some chance that they can get killed by some of the effects that kill people. Certainly you could kill them on your own. I don't know. Anyway, if he ends up in a negotiation, he's worth 10 extra bucks, which is kind of pleasing for Charles XII. He also took Oliver Cromwell. Remember, Charles sucks at negotiation. Now, he has a pregame ability to avoid a negotiation, but if I put Cromwell into a battle, I can use him as the enhancement, and if it happens to come out as a tie, I just win the negotiation, and this can't be blocked, and it exhausts Cromwell. That's very much like my ability, but I've just baked it into something even better. And finally, I got kind of stuck with a low-end artist after removing one of my luminaries, or one or more. I get an art and a buck. And I'm kind of looking at, well, that's kind of cool, because Sweden's not terribly wealthy, perhaps. It's hard to tell, because it's really these guys who make you wealthy. And speaking of which, I could probably use some wealth. I'm not really worried too much about the cultural aspect, except in terms of how they kind of develop for me. I may end up picking some of them later, but, you know, I'm just getting a random draw anyway. So I'm going to grab a politician here, and I get to Teria. Executes his own when intended in an when included in an attack. Remove one luminary from your stack after it's complete. Exhaust Terraria. This is interesting because sometimes you want to get rid of people, but you also want to play them. So this is a very valuable way of getting rid of some people that are in my hand, but either aren't doing me any good, or military guys who aren't as exciting as I might want them to be. Unfortunately, he's not what I was looking for. He's not going to generate any great wealth for me, so I'll probably have to draw that again. Over here for Peter, we've got the Patriarch Nikon, which is awesome. I had this in the other game. On any action he participates in that enhances anti-Catholicism, I advance an additional anti-Catholicism and an art, but I lose a science. Now that's a problem because, you know, I could just concentrate on not science, but unfortunately I grabbed Leibniz as well, which is probably dumb, except each time I win any cultural census, he gives me 2 extra science, and he's good at science. I think I might be able to be good at art. And the religious thing I'm counting on, hey, you know, I've got the benefit. He's anti-Catholic, so I've got the benefit. I can play him in an anti-Catholic position. You can't play people of the wrong religion to yours in cultural censuses for religion. So, you know, a Catholic would not really want this because that cuts him out of a third of the cultural checks. And then military, I took Conde, who gives me... when I play him, I can retrieve 2 cards from my exhausted pile and include them in my stack, which probably means I want more military leaders, because this only works when I'm making an attack. So, do I need military or do I need cash more? You know, I'm going to have a chance to go for both. Let's grab a military for now. And we get Long Ben. Looks like another pirate. Action taking of Ganji Sawai. Choose a colonial power to pirate. Take half their money. Round it down. It removes Ben. Well, that'd be nice, you know, to hit somebody like Spain with their piles of money. So, we're probably going to fire that off pretty early. Over here for Sobieski, we have Pope Innocent. That was a cool draw. Remember, those are completely random. During an attack action, if you're not part of it, after the stacks are created but before they're revealed, you choose a participant, and he loses an amount of points equal to the money you have in cash on hand. That can be really potent, especially in terms of influencing religious conflict, you know, conflict that's going to move the religious marker. So that's appealing to me. I can help the Catholics out with that. Unfortunately, my artist was not a great choice. Anytime Catholicism advances, I can use this as a response. Now, this might be kind of powerful. I get a bonus point of art, right? And he's pretty good on the art side, so I might be able to compete well in art. And I took Turin as my military. He gives me +2 for himself and every other luminary with a combat ability. I'm kind of looking at, well, I'm probably going to go against the Ottomans. Now, I have to do I have to declare war on the Ottomans to fight them. And other people can ally with the Ottomans and help them. They're just not a player. They're not going to play cards. They're an automatic NPC baked into the game no matter what. Maybe the original design had them as a player and then chose, yeah, they don't really work because the religious thing, as it began to congeal, it didn't make sense to leave them in. Or maybe not. Because I get bonuses for each military luminary I throw in, I'm going to want military, but I'm also going to probably want to get some economic power here. I have some in the Pope, and I probably am not going to use his ability right off, so I'm going to grab another military leader. Now, everybody's kind of aware of what, I got another damn pirate. Choose a colonial power to pirate, take 5 money from them, and remove kid. You know, again, I'm probably going to kick off early on this, get some extra cash early, just to bank. I don't have a lot of money to begin with. Here for Leopold. He too has a Pope, Innocent. After another player first announces a response, you can cancel it, and you return the luminary to their hand. This exhausts him. But he's really good at creating money for me, so he's probably going to constantly be pushed into here, unless there's some real worry in place. Descartes. So Descartes' light bulbs, ideas, count as political when you're doing religious action censuses. It counts as money for art actions, one of the pairings, and then it's double in science value. So he can create a lot of light bulbs for you for the science. This is pretty potent. I figure this is going to make me good at all the censuses, so I'm going to keep, you know, so I went with Descartes because he seemed like one of the best of the arts and science choices. And then DeWitt. DeWitt's ability is he's not exhausted when he does diplomacy, nor is he exhausted when used in negotiation. I don't know how valuable that is, but if I'm getting, you know, attacked a lot, that could be useful for the negotiations. And you can do a diplomacy to begin with and, you know, take one of your opponents out of the way. Plus, he gives me a lot of political position for that. What I'm lacking completely here is any military at all. That sounds like a horrible position to be in, so let's draw one. And we get another pirate, Captain Morgan. When he's included in an attack against a colonial power, he takes half the remaining money, rounded down, but then gets removed. Well, Can I exchange it for rum? Over here for the Spaniards, we have Alexander VII, whose ability is on any action he participates in that advances Catholicism. I get an extra point of Catholicism and an extra art, but I lose a science. He's sort of the opposite of the patriarch, who does the same kind of, or he's the same, but different religion. So he looked like, he looks like a Nietzsche pick. Remember, I didn't have a choice in that. Okay, Blake. Now, I got kind of the last military choice, but he's not a bad one. He's worth, it's only because there's so many obviously land powers, things like Austria and Poland and Russia, that he slipped through. He counts triple when he's involved in an overwater battle. That's pretty good for Spain to get that. And I think that would be the last choice, actually, was that. And then I got a good art choice, right? Because I was right off to the right of France. I took Newton, art and science. If you win a science census, you advance to the top of the science track, collecting all the remaining awards. So that would be my enhancement on the census. And, you know, with 6 science and 4 idea, I'm going to get a lot of power there. I have a little bit of money here. I'm not quite sure what I want to do. I guess I'll draw a politics. And I get the Elector of Bavaria. I gain a Catholic and an art. And I remove the Elector of Bavaria and throw away 3 bucks. This is a one-time action that I can just use to get some points over on the tracks. And given that I'm Catholic, that's not too terrible. He's also not a horrible leader. I may not use his action right away, but I may. And now we start over again with the French picking another one. We're going to do this 6 more times, and I'm not going to go through them all. But I'm giving you an idea of what kind of thinking is involved in these. You kind of want to balance your hand. Now, with the what I learned is going for the arts, science, and the religion is kind of iffy to begin with, because there's 3 turns before we have any of these, and we don't know what those are. There may be another couple of blanks, you know, real early on. So it's bad to have lousy people in your hand that you don't need right away. You can always discard people. If you knew you were going to get, you know, the best of each type or whatever, sure, you could pick those and keep them because they're going to be helpful everywhere. But you kind of want to put some thought into, yeah, what do I need for those first 3 when I know there isn't going to be a cultural census? So I think we're going to kind of shy away from everything except politics and military, although some people might throw some in, because you can be surprised. Art can come with some money on it. The religion certainly can come with money. As you can see, it's not necessarily the favorites that are the best ones, though. We saw some nice non-favorites, right? Nah, Blake was a favorite. Yeah, we haven't seen anything too potent that's not a favorite, but there are some that are pretty damn nice. As we're pushing through, you know, people feel like they've got enough income, they've got enough military to defend themselves. It may not be great to expand early in the game because you got to pay maintenance on expansion. Spain is the one exception to that. They have the not having to pay upkeep on conquered territories, so they may be the most expansionist early on. Some people are starting to look at things that'll gain them, you know, drawing for actions that'll gain them something on one of the tracks. And some of these, for example, this time, anytime you get Catholicism advanced, you get a bonus art if you play him with it. So I could play Marquette here, who's going to advance Catholicism, and then get that. And that sounds like a good action to start with early, because I'll move the Catholicism marker, but I'll also get something that's real, that's really mine. Because the religious war, you know, that affects half the people positively. It also affects half of them negatively, but you're not really gaining necessarily on other people with that. So a lot of people are kind of targeting that kind of thing. Other people are finding, hey, I don't really have enough income for my country. I think we had this issue with the Swedes. They were having real trouble finding income. And they have a bit of a navy, so they actually have something of a maintenance cost. Basically, the more your military is naval oriented, the more you're going to pay. But it's not guaranteed. So like Leopold pays 3 for a 6-1 military. Russia pays 1 for a 5-1. Poland pays 2 for a 7-1. So these things are not, you know, absolutely just what your military is made up of. But in general, if you have a strong navy, you end up paying more for it than you're paying for the land. So like Britain's paying 5 because of their Big Ten navy. France is paying 4, which is a pretty good price for that combined force. But, you know. Anyway, I got a couple more cards to pick for everyone. This is going to be a very expensive game to play solitaire. It takes a lot of thought playing it opposed, too, where you're sitting there looking at your cards, trying to make a judgment. You don't know what's going to happen. It's all very random because the value of the different cards is very different. But, you know, so you can get someone who's kind of crappy. So, for example, here, D'Artagnan is not very powerful at all. He's got really crappy ratings. His special ability, though, is kind of cool. If you can use him as an enhancement, and I'm really torn as to how enhancements are supposed to be used. I've seen cards that go both ways. This one's one that seems to go the opposite direction in terms of the wording to the others. Before the money stacks have been revealed, you choose to double D'Artagnan's contributions. Well, he has no contribution. It doesn't have that add him into the stack type wording that another one has. After the battle, you remove him. So he becomes a 6-point military, which isn't too bad. Of course, you're using up your enhancement to get that. 6 points is better than, I think, anything else. Others are like 5, but, you know, some of them have like triple their military or whatever. It's also kind of cool that you can remove this lousy card without having to, you know, take an action to do the reorganize and draw new cards. You kind of want to make sure you're right around 10 cards. A little over is okay. A little under sucks because you don't have a full hand. And there is a card that destroys favorites. So definitely I have no problem with what I've been deciding to go along with. One is players can destroy their own favorites if they don't like them using reorg. That's not a problem. But the exhaust, if the exhaust pile gets randomly, you know, drawn from or something, hey, that's not that big a deal either. Now everybody has their deck of 10 cards, and it's their hand of 10 cards as well, because they have nothing exhausted. And now we turn over these early ones and see what we get. So that's going to be religion, science, and then finally the arts. I can remove these. I'll use one of these as a turn marker to push me, well, up until I get to where we're going to have counters for everything. So this is now turn one. If this was one of the cultural censuses at the beginning, I'd have to use something else as a marker. And then eventually you clear up and it's clear for what turn you're on by where the next marker is. So, let's pick someone. Let's do this French since they're the first player. But they don't have to. Everybody's doing this simultaneously. And this is the thinking involved in a turn, is you kind of look at your entire hand and try to figure out what you want to do. Now, maybe I want to jump into a war at first, but I didn't really set myself up for that. So, the first thinking I have is, okay, I got these guys. On any action that advances religion, I get a science. This advances me a religion and a science. This would give me an additional science, if I'm in a science. This advances a science and costs me money. Now, I I don't start with a whole lot of money, but I also don't have a humongous, well, I do have a high initial upkeep cost, but I don't have any territories, so I don't really mind spending money. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to take De Medici, who will advance me a science and cost me money, and let's put Hook with him, and that'll give me an additional science. So I'm playing an action with an enhancement. What about my other action? Well, I could actually go for playing him. Now, there are, I think arts is artsman and craftsman. I'm not sure. Because these are scientists, everything else is kind of... So let's try to look, because I'm not gaining... I don't have anybody to gain me arts, but that's okay. The reason I want to do these with Louis is his penalty in the cultural census. This means he's unlikely to push forward in these, so he's particularly interested in these. So now I want to make sure I have a reasonable tax base as well. And for that, I need politics. There's one politics. And money. And unfortunately, it's not trivial for me to get both. So this is 4 and 3. I'll put Pascal. That brings it to 4 and 4. Because he's got a buck on him. This guy helps me in combat, so I'd rather not spend him, but unfortunately, this would leave me with only enough money to cover my costs. I am going to get money from him if I throw him into this. So we'll make this our first action. We'll make this our second action. This is so far what we're doing is 4 and 4. I don't want to spend him. He's too important for me to fight. As the defender, I get to suck out 2 of my opponent's luminaries and make him exhaust them without effect. This guy allows me to double my money if I throw them into anything. And these guys are only adding a buck each if I throw them into my tax base. And then finally, this can win me negotiation, but this is another card that gives me some combat capability. So obviously I'm not gonna be fighting. In fact, I'm not gonna be using any of my base actions over there. I'm gonna use these 2 cards to get me 4 bucks. 4 politics, 3 money, no politics, 1 money. I'll put that there. That'll make it so I don't lose too much for the turn. And I'm not going to count on, going to war anytime in the immediate future. Then I have to make this decision for all the other players as well. And you can see, that kind of thinking is going to take a bit of effort for each of these. We'll come back once we start actually resolving the actions. That also will take some time, especially since I have to worry about, and this is always a pain in the ass, so this is a response card. He always wins negotiations. That's not that big a deal if he plays this. But some of the responses have to do with actions that you're not even involved in. And if you've got one of those available, it might well be worth playing it. Especially if it allows you to get rid of a leader that maybe you're not thrilled with. The English also are going to do 2 actions. They have 1 to get them a science, some cash, and then they actually get a bonus art if they use this as their enhancement. So that sounds appealing. And then over here, they're going to go pirating which will give them $3 from a colonial power, and it just exhausts the Dread Pirate Roberts. For money, I got 3 here, 4 and 5 here. I might as well throw in an additional political. I'm not going to use this guy. Mollier, he's my favorite, so I'll get him back automatically. And that goes over in my taxation. The question is, what I want to do in terms of ordering here. The advancements that I get will bump the French off the chart if they stay where they are. But the French go before me. So I think I'm going to actually put those advancements as my second action. And see what plays out, because if they play too early, it might leave me in a position where other people are going to drop off. And then I've got this whole handful of cards that I could keep. Now, I could create more money, but I want to keep military leaders for the need for military. This guy might as well get added to my income. And this guy might as well get added to my income. Since I only have 10 cards, I don't really have to worry about the danger of discarding cards, because I'm going to get them back. If I had played one of the base actions, the reorganize action, I might end up with more cards, and then I might be worried about discarding too many from my hand. There are some anomalous situations that can occur in the game. My wife ended up in one where she had more than 7 non-favorites in her hand, more than 10 cards total. We kind of were in a position where there's nothing that handles that in the rules. Hey, you know, exhaust the additionals. You know, that seemed to be the sensible thing to do. I see they're doing a remake, semi-remake, in terms of they put another version of the rules out to maybe clearer, but they're also doing some sort of expansion that gets rid of some of the stuff that I kind of like about the game. So one of the things is they got rid of the dice for combat, and I kind of like the dice for combat. I can see where Euro players wouldn't like that, but honestly, I like a little variability in my game. I don't like everything to be calculable. And this game is already painful enough with the big hands of cards. Of course, it's also trying to reduce the hand size. But I don't know how much you can reduce that and still have kind of flexible and interesting choices. I know a lot of people trash this game. Some people liked it. I think they're trying to make it appeal to the people who don't like it so much. And in doing so, I'm afraid that they're going to actually make it into something that's not pleasant to the people who like it. And maybe, it seems unlikely to me that people are going to give it a second chance with an expansion and buy a special expansion to it if they didn't like it to begin with. They probably pawned it off and, you know. Sweden's going to choose something a little bit more violent. Now, remember, attacking the neutrals is dangerous because everybody can play in that. So I'm not going to do that. What I'm going to do is a land battle. I'm going to come from Estonia and try to go into Livonia. Wait, is Livonia mine? Livonia looks like it's mine. I'm sorry, I'm going to go from Livonia into some place like Courland. That looks easy to attack. I have... against the Poles, I have a +3. If I use land combat, only a +2 in naval, so I'll probably use land. I put an attack card. I associate some people with this. In terms of abilities, I'm just really looking for strength points there. But in order to get that attack to work, and I'm going to make this my second action. I need to exhaust 5 politics to declare war. So this card is going to go into my hand. I'm going to hold on to that. That'll get exhausted separately. He's not part of the battle. For my cash, I want it to do... Okay. I want to hold this card to defend myself. Worried that I didn't... I had this all figured out, but I apparently not well. Yeah, I think I wanted to use this guy over here. Which means... This is going to be my cash. I've got four politics and four money that I'll be assigning to cash. And then my other action, I wanted to hold on to this guy for a defensive action because he's very good. He's tripled value to his military and to his diplomacy if need be. If I'm being invaded or if I'm invading my own home territory. So I'm going to put him aside. And that leaves me a series of artists, one of which I can choose. None of them are going to be enhancements. I don't have... Well, I could exhaust this and take the advanced three. I would remove this guy. I'm not sure how terribly good he is. I'd get three art right away. But I'm going to be getting a lot of art. This guy I don't want to do unless I'm charging a lot of people and I have to exhaust an idea to use him. So I'm going to hold off on using him as well. since I want a lot of artists for him, I'm just going to play the weakest of these and I don't have to spend anything to use him. So I'll put him as my first action. These other two will go up here. And they're going to be my, you know, reserve hand. I just don't have anything to use them on, but it makes it look like I have a bigger defensive hand. Now, for the attack, I'm going to get, it looks like, five, six, seven, and I could kill someone, including himself, possibly, I guess, 11. However, I may want to use his enhancement instead of his because he wins my negotiations. I just have to announce I'm using an enhancement before we reveal the cards, though. I don't have to announce which one it is. So then, you know, once we do reveal, I can make my choice which one seems more likely. But if I've got 9, 10, 11 dice, well, 11 points, and another 10, another 3, that's 14 points coming in here if the Poles don't defend. And then with a defensive value of 2, I'm going to need 3 successes if I'm not using Cromwell's ability. Only 2 if I am. So that looks fairly likely, at least with Cromwell's ability in play. So we'll just pile these here. Note that I've got one of my base attack cards in there. You probably don't want to reveal that on top because you almost always have a character involved in something you're doing. So putting the other cards on top helps show things. It might be a good idea, actually, to put the active action on the bottom of your pile as just a general policy. And if you don't have an action there in the census, that becomes clearer. Of course, if all you do is put P people with actions down for the senses. It's still not going to solve that possible issue. Look at the Russian plans, which are also to invade Poland. What I see is, and they want to do this in part because they can change the religious modifier. There's just advantages to going in those directions. What I see, though, is, wow, there are spaces where the Ottomans would presumably be able to attack. You know, which kind of points more towards it being another player. But I'm kind of wondering if there might be a way of adding NPC roles. It would essentially be cards that allowed you, if you have an ally or whatever, to be able to use that ally to generate an attack. Because it would be hard to get a game of 7-8 people together for something like this. This is a fairly long game for most groups, I think. Certainly at cons you can do things like that, but a little odd. A design flaw with the cards. The values that are placed here, since you have to match them up, it'd be nice if they were in similar locations at least. Maybe not always the exact same location, but at least in a similar order. But they're not. They're like scrambled. So, you know, this guy's a blue card, so he has his blue on top. But this guy's green, so his green's on top. His blue's way at the bottom below everything else. So you kind of have to add things up by, like, you know, looking all over the cards. And when you're looking at a significant number of cards to make this decision for the pairings, it's just a pain in the ass. It's just a horrible factor in terms of playability for it. And somebody actually made a mention of this I saw over on Board Game Geek. They talked about, you know, hey, is there a way to make this simpler? Well, the way to make it simpler would have been to design the cards properly. and you know, the game designer comes back to say, yeah, we understand that's hard, but you'll get more used to it as you play. Yeah, you get more used to it, but it could have been set up so that it was visually easier to handle. If they're doing any kind of reprint or anything, they should certainly consider redesigning the cards in this just simple manner. Hey, you know, you always follow that order. I don't care what kind of card it is. Always follow the same order, just so you can match things up easier. There might be other ways of, you know, I mean, the color background shows you pretty much what the guy's power is anyway. Instead, though, you know what they seem to sort them as? They seem to sort them from highest to lowest on each card. And that's just not an effective way to identify your matchings. And it doesn't particularly help you see what somebody's good at. You can, the big numbers jump out at you no matter where you put them. After checking all the cards to make sure that nobody has any responses left over that they can just kind of randomly play, I just wanted to make certain of that. There are responses you can jump in on other, on stuff you're not involved in. Everybody's actually committed those, so nobody's got any kicking around that they might want to play. Some of them especially are things that get rid of the card. Let's go to the French. And they get their first action. Now their first action, I've got two enhancements here. I did not need two, I don't think. Okay. But one of them I don't have to put into play. So I'm going to take the action of Innovative Architect. It'll advance Catholicism and science for the French. I have to remove him, and for each artist and craftsman also exhausted, I get $3. I'll be exhausting him for the $3. I'm not getting any art here, but on any action in which Pope Clement participates in that advances Catholicism, I get an extra science. So I'm going to be getting two religion and two science at once. Now, the religion, of course, doesn't just help me, but the science does. These guys are all going to be exhausted. He's being exhausted as well. So I get $3. I'll pull that from here. I'm going to have to get that out of my counter mix. I don't have extra coins kicking around right now. These go into the exhausted pile for later. I'll come back after I give him his money. Now, doing the odd thing of playing clockwise, we go to the Brits, and they flip theirs over. Action. Better being a commander. Choose a colonial power to pirate, take $3 from them, and this will just exhaust Roberts. Now, someone actually does have an anti-piracy card kicking around, but they're not going to play it unless it affects them. So the question here is, who does the English want to hit? Do they want to hit the Spaniards? Do they want to hit the French? Those are their only options. I'm going to roll a die for this, although honestly, both are potentially interesting, so I don't know. I'm probably more interested in Spain, but we'll do odd Spain, even France. We're going to be hitting France here. Nobody else who has the guy with the anti-piracy card does not want to play it. I have a response here, but it's not the right one. So Roberts goes here, $3 is transferred over to the English, and you know what? The English probably have too much money. I know at the end of the turn you check this, but I don't know if that maximum applies at all points during the turn. So let's check the treasury limit, see if it's listed here. There's no indication here that I see of it. Oh, maybe coin and wealth. The amount of coin each player holds is private, but not public information can be hidden, but they must exceed must make sure they don't exceed the treasury limit on their leaderboard. Now, elsewhere, under paying upkeep is where it definitely says you have to discard, but it also says under paying taxes, you may temporarily exceed your treasury limit at this point until you've paid your upkeep. So I think that money's just discarded. It was dumb of me to do things in that order. But I took some money away from the French, and it was kind of the best action that I guess I could do. I just may have had an action that's going to cost me. Oh, no. I only have $10. Only Spain starts with their full treasury, so no big deal there. Okay. Over to Sweden. Action in Rival's Shadow. Roll a die. On 1 through 3, I get an art. 4 through 6, I get $3. Get the money. The Poles, they're taking an action, custodian of spiritualities. That'll give me 2 anti-Catholic movement. It removes him, though, and I have to exhaust an anti-Catholic point. And I've got a pile of people back here, including Leibniz, who gives me the anti-Catholic point that I need to exhaust. So I advance 2. Now my enhancement here is brutal power. He just participated in something that enhanced anti-Catholic. That goes an additional point. Hey, we've swung the balance over. And he gets a point of art. I'm going to have to add... I can't open this one-handed, I don't think. Oh, yes I can. I'm going to have to add an art trigger here. This knocks here. It drops the French back. Because I ended up in their space, and that exhausts him, that removes him from play. So he goes to the bottom of the deck, and it's possible he could come back. And that was our Russians, not our Poles. Okay, now to our Poles, and they are also taking a advance Catholicism in their case, and that'll remove Marquette. At any time that Catholicism advances, I also gain a point of art. And that knocks the Russians off. He's exhausted. And this, well, is removed from the game, which is not that big a deal. Sometimes your initial pick gives you people that aren't terribly useful. Culling them isn't a bad idea, although it's going to mean I have less cards next time unless I did a reorg, which I did not. Over here to Leopold. Leopold takes overseas trader. This gives him $2 from each of the colonial powers. It's England and France and Spain. And that exhausts him. Over to the Spaniards. They took an action, aspiring dynastic, gain a Catholicism and an art, remove the Elector of Bavaria, and discard $3. That's not three wealth. It's $3. If it says exhaust, it's going to be wealth, though. Now, with this, I just gained a Catholicism. Yellow. You can see the fight for the art track has become kind of brutal. And this is where play order really matters, is when stuff like this is happening, and with some of the combat situations. So this advanced... Well, actually, no, this isn't gone yet. Hold on. Because these both take effect at the same time. This advances an additional Catholicism and an additional art, but it reduces my science. I don't have any, so I don't pay that penalty. And he's exhausted. Now, the Elector of Bavaria is removed, however. And he's a political guy. We went through a lot of the political guys, so those might come back. All right. And we'll continue in the same vein here. We have another action. Intrigued by technology, advance a science, and discard $3. Exhaust him. Okay. We're running low on money here. But we go forward a science. And if we can get to this chip, we get a bonus. And he says... Add to any action that you'll gain you a science and gain an additional. And he too is exhausted. Now remember, these are important victory points. First of all, there's the bonus of being the first there, but also being at the top of those charts. If you're the player at the top of the chart, you get like 3 victory points. I don't remember how it goes with ties. Oh, there are no ties. These are winner-take-all things. We go to the English, and they're also playing around with this. With an action, pumping water, advance a science, and gain $5. Hope I didn't take too much income. I'm making money. And now, whenever an action, and he's going to be removed, that gains science... You add an art, and he is removed as well. So we're losing 2 of our characters. We probably should do a reorg, but we had other things to do. So we'll be playing with a lesser deck next time. We get an art that bumps the poles out of there, and 2 leaders removed. Now, of course, these are my science guys. They would have been useful when I get to here, but that's a long way off. I can pull more if need be. Now things get interesting, I think. We have an attack action. All right. So I could attack a neutral, but that was not my plan. My plan's to attack Poland. In order to attack Poland, I need to have 5 points of politics. So I exhaust this and look for my little cubes. And we get a war between Poland and Sweden. I can do that without taking an action. Diplomacy always takes an action to get an alliance. Okay. Now, I don't show these, but I announce I'm doing an enhancement. I have three dudes. Am I throwing money in? It's probably a good idea. Money counts one for one in this fight. Let's see how much money I'm generating this turn, though. I'm generating $4. That's enough to support me even if I take this. So I'm going to throw $5 into the fight because I got to go first. Now, I know that Peter the Great is also going to attack Poland, but there's not much I can do about that. Now, the Poles have as their defense this pile. And I'm going to play a response. He's declaring that he's attacking Courland up here. I'm going to play a response. We know it's going to be a land battle as well, which will increase the defense rating by one. So this goes from a 2 up to a 3. And then I'm also going to be playing an enhancement. At this point, do I have money I want to throw in? How much money do I produce? I'm producing $2, two of these and four of those. I'm going to throw, I guess, about $3 in. Because I don't really want to lose territories. Doesn't terribly hurt me until victory. So this is what I'm going to throw in. Okay. Now we declare what we're doing. Or we show what we're doing. And so he can either take his negotiate bonus or... I'm sorry. He could either fire off and negotiate. He could do the execute at his own. But what I'm going to be doing is the enhancement large protector. If I end up with a tie, I win the negotiation. That's pretty cool for... Charles. Over here, his enhancement, he's using the Marshal General, which is going to be +2 for de Turin and every luminary with a gun rating in your stack. Okay, so now we add the totals. So we got 4, 9, 10, 11, 16, and a 3-point difference. Let's call that 19. 2021 is my total. Over here it's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 18. So it's only going to be 3 dice. I got to get all 3 hits to even tie. Of course, a tie is an automatic win. I don't get any 6s. That's what I'd need. So everybody's exhausted. The money's spent. And that was a failure by Sweden. Now, one of the problems is the sequencing can mean something. The fact that Sweden goes before... Fuck. What did I play? These are all... Poles. I don't know if I took money from there. I don't know. Russia started out with 5. They started out with 5. I don't remember what the actions were. I may have stolen money from Russia. I think I did. Let's switch those. I think it's very unlikely that the money would have been allocated the way it was. Okay. So, the fact that Sweden and Russia both go before Poland, that's something of an issue. The fact that Sweden goes before Russia means that if they're both attacking Poland, Sweden is almost always going to have to take the first swing. And that means Poland can use their defenses against them. It's pretty hard to hold off your defenses when you're being attacked. even though there's an advantage to being the second guy in. And speaking of which, the Russians here are also attacking. I have two enhancements. I am going to be attacking into Podolia, giving the Swedes more room to play around in. Might as well. And I'm going to use my I'm going to use an enhancement. I don't have a whole hell of a lot of combat ability, though. I have 8. I'm back 2 for this. I think I have a lot of money in here. And it doesn't... I don't need a lot. So I'm going to throw all 5 bucks in. The Swedes have nothing left. They're going to throw their 2 bucks into the fight. But they're out of cards. Okay, so the Russians are at 8. But I can also take 2 cards from my exhausted pile and include them. That doesn't sound like a bad idea. Now, since I use this as my enhancement, I can't use the brutal power as my enhancement, which is a pain because that could actually trigger things. This guy, well, he's not going to help me, but we'll include him anyway. So now I'm at 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 7, 5, I'm at 10. 10 dice. I need 3 successes since Russia's that gray number there. That's 1 success. And then I miss. And then all these Russian leaders and all the money go away. You can see attacking isn't necessarily terribly effective. But if you do succeed, it's worth a victory point, and it's going to cost you money to maintain the new territories. Over here to the Poles, well, they're being peaceful. Criticism, form, and poetry. Roll a die. Now, I'm going to have to exhaust him and a political point. Well, I used up all my dudes. I used up my political points there, so I get nothing for this action. I guess he's still exhausted, though. If I had guys left that had political power, I could have triggered that event. But now I'm in a war, and oh, I forgot. I gotta exhaust a Russian worth 5. And I swear I had one. Oh, damn it. I miscounted what I had. So Leibniz was supposed to be in there. He didn't give me anything. I don't know why he was included in this, but he couldn't do anything for me. So I didn't win a census. You can see the Russians aren't ahead on science. I have no idea what he was used for. So, yeah, he was supposed to be in here so that I could exhaust Rupert and that in order to put a little war marker between Russia and Poland. Okay. It's tough to keep up with everything when you're soloing. Okay, Leopold's also doing an attack. Oh, what are we attacking? Well, we would love to attack a Protestant, but we're really not adjacent to any. We could attack a Protestant up here. So, for example, well, we're not actually adjacent to any here either. But if we could have made our way to Protestants
over, wow, Switzerland's counted as Catholic, interesting, over here in North Germany, you know, we would get an advantage from that. We could keep picking on Poland, they're pretty weak, but our enhancement could double him and remove him. We could grab a lot of money with Morgan if we attack the Spaniards. My feeling, though, is do I really want to attack Poland? Because that's just going to help other people. There are a lot of players who aren't involved in wars, so I'm not going to be able to just scam my way into, you know, a neutral territory. I could conceivably pick on the Ottomans. Nobody can screw with me there. So I think that's what I'll do. It's not optimal, but... well, I have a lot here. Okay, I'm wondering why. I guess I needed him. Oh, he's combat capable. Okay, so we'll spend DeWitt to make a declaration of war on the Ottomans. And note, somebody could ally with the Ottomans and help them. Not right away, obviously. But Austria, Ottomans go to war. They don't have any value. See, normally when you have an NPC, they have a card and they have some military value. I don't believe the Ottomans do. All right. Well, there are really easy pickings then, like a neutral. They shouldn't be at this period, but okay. So I have 4, 7, 10. I could blow him away. He kind of sucks. So we'll go to 13. And 6 is 19 points. So I get 19 dice. I'm looking for 2 successes. There's none. Actually, I'm looking for 3, but... there's one. There's 3. So I have successfully conquered Bosnia. Well, that was easy. And I add it. Now that's worth a victory point if I hold on to it. I get to get rid of him. He's just not that good. And there's really no cost to me doing this, because except that I have to pay upkeep for it. And finally, we go to our final player's second action, which is Philip of Spain, who is doing a Fresco Master action. He doesn't have to pay anything for it, but I am going to have to pay a wealth. I'm going to have to exhaust a wealth for his enhancement that I'm using. So let's see if this works. I get a 2. I advance an art. I'm already on there. And now when I gain an art, I also gain a Catholicism if I can discard a wealth. And I have a wealth here, so I'll exhaust him. Catholicism goes further. These guys are exhausted. Now it's time for upkeep. And the final thing, and this can be done kind of all at once, is you determine your income for the turn. And so, for example, here we have 4 versus 4. Means that we're going to collect $4 for the French. We have to pay $4 each turn, so we break even. And the French are done. The interesting person here, there are a couple, so I'll take a look at the Holy Roman Empire, who has 2. I thought this was money. Oops.
Okay, so they collect $4. They only have to pay $3 out plus $1 for this, so they break even. We're kind of worried about Poland here because they have no money left. And some of these others. They have 4, 6, 10 versus 6, 7. So I'm going to collect $7 for the Poles. But two of that has to be spent on my maintenance. Now, if I can't pay that, there's a penalty no matter what. But the penalty might be pretty minor. It might just be losing a random luminary. I'll do the rest of them, and then we pass the turn marker to the next player and move on. The wealth disparity is kind of funny because, like, England and Spain actually produced too much to even collect all their money. Had they been attacked or something, they would have had an opportunity to spend a lot of their money on defense, make sure they couldn't be hit. But they both hit maximum. Now remember, Spain started at maximum, so it's not hard for them. And Britain had a big influx of money in addition to their taxation. Okay. Now, each player regains their cards. Now, they get all their favorites, and they get their other cards up to a total of 10 cards. Now, since nobody gained any cards so far, everybody's just going to get their entire hand back, whatever they have left. If they lost cards due to permanently losing them, well, then they're playing with a smaller deck. They don't get the whole thing. And finally, we move this marker forward, as I mentioned. We'll move this up to turn two, and we're ready to start. This video has gone more than I expected, so we'll load it up.